It's Freedom Files with James Burns.
Welcome to the Freedom Files podcast for this Thursday, April 12th, 2012. I am James Burns. We are joined now by Bob Chapman. His website is theinternationalforecaster.com. Bob, how are you doing, sir?
Okay.
Yeah. I kind of feel that day some days, too. Like, yeah, I'm okay. Yeah, I'll get back to you on that. Whether or not, you know, the rest of the day, the week, the year goes, we'll find out. Bob, there's several things going on around the world. I thought I'd let you have the floor and talk about which one of these items is most important to you and the one that everyone needs to know about first.
And what are they? Do you have a list?
I do have a list. We could talk about what's going on in the European Union. We could talk about Santorum dropping out. Or anything else, Bob, that you think is very, very important to what is going on right now?
Well, Santorum dropping out really surprised me, shocked me. And so I really haven't delved into why he did what he did. And the only thing I can think of probably is they were both setups. And those setups pertain to the candidacy of Mitt Romney and Santorum, essentially one and the same thing. And maybe it doesn't seem that way, but that's the way these people operate. I can't envision it further than that. I don't know how many delegates have been available to Ron Paul. I guess we'll find out in the not too far distant future. But conceivably, could the addition of Santorum votes add to Mr. Paul's possible election as the Republican who would run for the presidency? I can't give you an answer on that one. Europe's easier. Now, the people want out of the Europe. What's that?
No, we'll come back to the politics in a moment, and we'll go ahead and talk about the European Union and their situation.
The European Union, the German people, some of the Dutch, some of the Finns, and some of the Austrians really want out of the euro. And, of course, the politicians and bureaucrats want to keep their positions. On the other hand, they're in love with world government, those characters I just mentioned. And they have gone against the will of the people in each of those countries. In fact, I don't even know if Holland has come to a political agreement on budget cuts, which that deficit that they have, which is 4.5% of GDP, they want to take it back down to 1%. It happened because they lent money to the ailing fellow members of the European Union who are in the Eurozone. But that is an absolute powder keg. And all these nations have approved the new ESM, and the German government says, or the German courts say, you can't do that. So that's another thing they have to deal with. The Germans have another fund, a secret fund, and I don't have the information in front of me either. And that's to back up the possibility of going back to the Deutschmark, I think they get about $1 trillion put aside. And so I think the Greek problems are going to sort of set this on fire. And I see no possibility of Greek not defaulting. I think they'll default. And it might not be right away. It might take a month or two or three, but it's going to happen. I mean, people are immolating themselves in the streets by committing suicide, by shooting themselves in the head. But there's millions and millions of these people who are starving to death. And nothing is made of it in the media. Obviously, they don't care. And the two major parties together are not going to get a majority from the polling that's been shown so far. So if they have a minority government, what's going to happen is that agreement is going to be broken. And and when it's broken, they'll have to default. So Europe is a catalyst.
Bob, how many countries within the European Union, like Germany, France, others, would, how many of them would have to go back to their currencies before a total collapse of the euro?
Well, all one of the majors would have to say is, I don't want to do that anymore. That would be Germany, France, Holland, and Finland.
So basically, once that happens, once these countries say we want out, we're done, we're going back to the Deutschmark, we're going back to our currency, basically that's going to be the beginning of the end for the euro, right?
I think so. And I think it'll be pushed by Greece.
Yeah, I've definitely been reading about how and you've talked about this as well, Bob, several times, how there's a growing number of people within Greece that, you know, they want a default, they want out. It's not their debt. They don't really owe anything, but they're being held at gunpoint. And there's a lot of them that want to go back to their currency as well.
Well, it's not a majority in the other countries, just in Germany.
I think it's only a matter of time, Bob, before that number does start to grow, and you see more and more people throughout these countries starting to wake up and say, you know something, yeah, this euro thing is not really working out. And it wouldn't surprise me before long, Bob, when you will see majorities in all these countries throughout the eurozone rallying in the streets, wanting out of the EU and wanting to go back to their old currency system before the euro took over.
I agree. I think you will see that. And you started to see the. Go ahead.
All right. I was just going to do a quick little re-intro. Bob Chapman is my guest. His website, theinternationalforecaster.com. And sorry about that, Bob.
Okay. I forgot what I was going to say anyway.
Yeah, it's one of those days. But the EU situation, it's continuing to deteriorate faster and faster with each passing week. And like you said, it's not a question of if, it's a question of when this whole thing is going to collapse in on itself.
I think that's a fair statement.
Definitely. And moving back across the Atlantic to the economic situation in the U.S., Bob, how would you gauge us in comparison to what's going on in the EU right now?
What's going on in the States?
Yeah, would you say that what's happening here is better, worse, or about the same?
Well, I think it's worse at the moment, but it'll get worse. If there's a word, worse or whatever.
Yeah, I agree with you on that one, Bob. It's definitely going to be going basically from a bad to worse to nightmares. So we're heading towards much darker roads, and that's something else that you talk about as well, the need for people to be preparing for that and to be buying precious metals, gold, silver, if they can afford it. Also storing on freeze-dried food, getting some water, getting some Second Amendment devices in order to prepare for what's coming their way.
And they better hurry.
Bob, do you see the U.S. dollar deteriorating to the point in value to where it would be basically equivalent to what happened to the Weimar mark, or do you think it would be a little bit better value-wise or possibly even worse?
No, I think it'll be much less, based upon what I see right now. I think, 30 to 50% inflation is good enough to turn everything upside down.
And when this transpires, Bob, say, for example, you have $1 million in the bank. What will that be technically worth after, say, a bank run and a readjustment, as they say?
Well, that's really a hard call because, you could say from what we've seen over the past 40 years that in all probability, a two-thirds reduction in the value of the dollar certainly would be warranted. But they're not going to do it in isolation. They're going to have a meeting. All the countries will be there. Everybody's currency will be swapped against another currency, and everything will be either revalued or devalued versus the currency in question. I mean, you match it up, Mexican pesos versus Chilean pesos or whatever. And I think there'll also be a default. And what those percentages are, I just can't say. But I think that's the way they're going to do it. And so don't anybody think they're going to do it unilaterally, because they're not.
Not at all. And Bob, do you think that we'll still keep our currencies, or do you think that this is part of a greater scheme to introduce a one world currency?
That's a greater scheme, but we know what they want to do, but it's just not doable.
No, it's not. I mean,
they don't think so. They think it is doable, but I don't think it is.
I don't think it is either, Bob. I mean, as you've pointed out time and time again, the perfect template for this whole system, how they thought it would work with Europe, with the euro, and just with that one region of the globe, we see how disastrous it's been. Imagine if they tried that on a much grander scale, like the entire globe.
It'd be chaos. They're going to have to create another unit. Either our people are going to have to continue to use the currencies that they have been using, with the exception of the euro. And they'll all take the cuts that they need to take in the value of their currencies and refrain from manipulating their currencies to get advantage.
Yeah, and their end goal, of course, is obviously they want to control us. They do so through the currency, through manipulation of the markets and derivatives. And eventually, I don't know what their plan is, obviously, but they have something very bad in store for us when it comes to that, because as long as they control the money supply, they control us and over any goods and services that we need. Unfortunately, we live in a society now, Bob, where you basically, well, with a few exceptions across the planet, you need money in order to basically survive on a daily basis.
Well, as you've seen recently with Iran and its trading of oil, they've broken down into, in part, a barter system. And so what would that lead you to believe in Western Europe, England, and the U.S. might happen? we might be exchanging gold and silver coins as the finite currency. And there's a lot of these people in Greece are bartering hempen for the last year, and when the summer starts very shortly, a lot of other people will get involved. And that would be, you know, like, I'll trade you these 8 carats for 2 squash or something like that. And that's the way it's going. Because I put reports in and letters from Greeks that this is underway.
And what we see happening in Greece, Bob, is basically just a sign of things to come for the rest of the world, including here in the U.S. I mean, I foresee a time coming not too far from now when we don't know how far the dollar's value is going to deteriorate. That's anyone's guess. We'll know, obviously, whenever it happens, but I think that it's going to get to a point where people are going to have no choice, Bob, but to barter with their neighbors, you know, exchanging, like you said, carrots, tomatoes for other items such as water, hygiene products. You know, I see a bartering system eventually, organically developing. And I would say this, too. I think that's actually... compared to the alternative, which would probably be neighbor turning against neighbor, you know, everyone being at each other's throats. I think a bartering system is probably a much more favorable outcome, Bob.
And I think that could happen. But it would probably be accompanied by revolution or some sort of action by government against the people. Mm-hmm. You know, we see these people being trained by the U.S. military, who are in law enforcement and FEMA, how to put down the public.
Yeah, and we've seen that over the past year that the not just the past year, but we'll stick with the, you know, what's happened with the Occupy movement, for example, going out protesting. I don't entirely agree with their points of view on the issues, but, you know, under the First Amendment, they do have a right to, you know, freedom of speech. But you see how the police in New York, Boston, Seattle, Oakland, and other cities have responded to the occupiers, and it's been in a very violent way.
Which is unnecessary, too.
Absolutely. It's unnecessary. It's excessive, and the only thing it does, Bob, is it leads towards more resentment towards law enforcement and more people rising up and continuing to protest against what's going on. And eventually, and I know we've talked about this before, you know, if this continues, you know, this push and shove back and forth between police and protesters, not just with the occupiers, but any other group that should start protesting in the near future, and I think we're going to see a lot more of that as time progresses, but eventually I do see it getting violent.
Unfortunately, you're right. And if you have a demonstration, you stand the chance of being attacked for no reason whatsoever. And they want incidents. I mean, look at this situation in Florida a month and a half ago. A white man, actually a Hispanic, shot a black American. Now they've come back and charged the shooter. I don't think there's a chance that the shooter will be convicted under the law. And they know that in Washington. And that's going to perhaps put us on to track in a race war. And I think the intelligent black community knows that. I mean, as black children get shot every day by gangbangers and hoodies because they get in the line of fire. Last weekend, 40 in Chicago. I mean, the streets are deadly places. And that didn't start a movement to make sure that somebody was blamed for it and goes to jail. They are creating incidents to create incidents, and that's where I think that's going.
Sadly, Bob, I agree with you. It's heading towards some sort of violent confrontation. And this whole situation in Florida has been intentionally blown way out of proportion. Yes, a young 17-year-old man lost his life. But I, from everything I've looked at, it doesn't look like it was racial at all. I mean, you look at Zimmerman's track record. He's half Hispanic. His mom is Peruvian. I don't know if he's divorced or when he was married, he was involved with helping several less fortunate African-American children. And he had several African-American friends. So obviously he wasn't out there, you know, trying to, gun down an African-American. And, you know, another fact is that a lot of people don't talk about is, well, he was part of this neighborhood watch. I mean, this young man was walking around in the rain in a hoodie, and he started it. I mean, yeah, I mean, he called 911, Zimmerman did, you know, and the police were on their way. And then he was approached by Trayvon Martin, and Trayvon attacked him. He didn't have to attack him. The moment he physically assaulted Zimmerman, and there's plenty of people that said that this is exactly what happened. I mean, that's when self-defense is allowed.
Oh, you're right. I mean, if you think you're in mortal fear of your life, you're going to use any artifice whatsoever to protect yourself from being killed.
And I think what it comes down to is, Trayvon made a mistake. He shouldn't have attacked Zimmerman. And it's sad that it happened. It's sad that he's no longer here. And what's even more tragic is how it's been twisted and manipulated. And they're always out there demonizing this law, the Stand Your Ground law in Florida. Yet, Bob, I have yet to see one report come out talking about all the lives that have been saved because of this law. How many people in Florida are still alive because they had this law which allowed them to protect themselves from attackers?
That was known and unknown. Well, I have a Florida concealed carry. And if I was in the position that Mr. Zimmerman was in, and I was going through what he went through, I certainly would have shot him. The guy was big and strong and in wonderful condition. And sometimes you have no choice.
No, you don't. And it's, again, it's sad what happened down there. It's tragic, but you see all these different groups. You see the administration. You see Jesse Jackson, Al Sharpton, and you have the mainstream media out there as well. NBC, they intentionally edited that 911 call to make it sound like Zimmerman was an outright racist when he wasn't. It was the dispatcher that asked him, you know, what was the race of the suspect, and he says, well, he looks black. And obviously, you know, just another prime example, Bob, of the mainstream media out there doing what they can to distort, lie, and stir the pot.
It's true. Par for the course.
And then to make matters worse, Bob, you do have these hate groups out there taking advantage of this situation. You have the neo-Nazis, they're riding around on the streets in Sanford. I saw that article a week ago. You know, they're looking for trouble. And so on the other side is the new Black Panther Party. And their chief of staff, Michelle Williams, over the past weekend, she was hosting a Black Liberation radio show and had several well, the Black Panthers calling the show, and they were calling white people all sorts of wonderful racial names, and they basically were calling for a race war this past Monday. Fortunately, you know, it just shows you that the majority of Americans, you know, do not share the views and opinions of the new Black Panthers or any of these other hate groups. But now she's coming out to talk about how she's so sorry and how emotional she was. But here's my question. Why are you a member of a hate group? Why are you chief of staff of a hate group? Why are you apologizing? It's obvious that you're a member of a group that doesn't exactly like others that don't look like you.
That's a good question. Well, whatever the reason is, so far she hasn't been effective, and I hope it stays that way.
Yeah. I mean, I don't want any repercussions done to her either or anyone else. Even though her words were hateful, I respect her freedom of speech. I respect her right under the First Amendment to say whatever she wants to say. But you can't go off saying, well, here's a quote. She said, "My words were out of anger. I did not incite. I did not promote, nor did I encourage anyone to go pick up a gun." Well, I mean, what do you call that dead or alive bounty that your new Black Panthers were putting all over the place for Zimmerman's head? I mean, and all this racial war and all this hate towards white people. I mean, it sounds like to me, Bob, she was, and you know, several of her cohorts were inciting race.
Of course.
Yeah, but you know what? If you had, say, for example, chief of staff of, say, a neo-Nazi party here saying the same, you know, stuff on the other side of the spectrum, oh, it would be a big deal. A big deal. It would be all over the mainstream media. The president would be, you know, coming out, you know, talking against it. You'd have, you know, speeches, more riots. But, you know, it's just sad because my point of view is racism is racism. It doesn't matter which group is doing it. Hate is hate.
That must mean that the U.S. government or some of those foundations have stopped funding the Ku Klux Klan. I didn't hear anything from them.
No. And what's sad, Bob, is they're so busy, the government, going around, you know, putting us on lists, calling us terrorists, accusing us of being in hate groups, you know, all of our pro-Ron Paul, Constitution, Freedom, Liberty groups out there, when all we're talking about is we just want to be left alone. We want individual rights. We want less government. We want less tyranny. Yet the new Black Panthers can go out to a polling place on Election Day in 2008 in Philadelphia with clubs and threaten white voters. That's fine. And they can go on the radio spouting hatred and calling for a race war. I mean, why aren't they on a list?
Good question.
But I think you're right, Bob. I think that they're definitely up to something. They're definitely planning and using this to their advantage. And it seems more and more apparent every day that they are just trying to get something bad to really start happening in that area when it comes to the sensitivity of racial relations in this country. They want a race war. They want people killing each other in the streets.
I think you're right.
And you've warned about this for the past 2 weeks now. You've been on the podcast, you know, since we've been covering this. I mean, you went out and you've told people, you know, don't get involved in this. Don't become part of this because it's going to end badly for everybody.
Well, you know, the law enforcement is supposed to protect everybody, and some of these people who are militant will shoot at the police and then later on expect them to protect them. Really strange thought process.
It is indeed. And I sincerely hope that somehow we can get over this. I mean, I know we have a history of issues when it comes to race relations in this country. I like to believe personally that I think we've gotten a lot better over the past 50 years in that regard. But if, with the way the situation is now, the economic situation, the government out of control, you know, stripping away our rights, freedoms, and liberties, destroying the Constitution and Bill of Rights, With everything else going on, Bob, the deterioration of the dollar, the rise in unemployment, and the cost of, well, food, oil, gas. I mean, this is all, it looks like it's all coming together to become a perfect storm.
Impacting the system. It's a good point. And, you know, during the month of May, in Europe there's going to be lots of problems. And probably June as well. And you'll have that for a semi-catalyst, we'll call it. I mean, in Los Angeles, they're paying $7 a gallon for gasoline. The average person probably commutes an hour each way. Maybe it's even longer. And, you know, what's that going to cost them? Well, it's going to cost them double what it cost them last year. And car, vehicle, getting 15 miles to the gallon, in that would be about 10 gallons. So you're looking at $14 round trip to get to work and home.
Yeah, and there's plenty of Americans right now, Bob, that already have it tough enough as it is. I mean, they're barely, you know, living paycheck to paycheck. They're in debt. They have several credit cards right now just to try and, you know, put food on the table, pay the car note, the mortgage, the utilities. And not only that, obviously we have to have car insurance in this country, and those rates are going up. And compound that with the oil gas prices as well, there's going to be a lot of people that can no longer afford to go to work.
And they'll try to find some sort of welfare so they can weather the storm. And very few people save money. The figures are still the same now as they were in the 1950s. 10% of the population at time of retirement ends up with $20,000 or the equivalent thereof.
And that is really not much money to survive on in the grand scheme, especially since a lot of people end up living several years and several decades long after they retire.
Mm-hmm. And what happens if we have a situation where the retirements are all taken away from everybody? Just like they were in Greece. That's why the man shot himself in the head.
You're right. I mean, once again, you look at Greece, and every time we talk about Greece, Bob, it just, everything that's been going on there, the violent protests, how they've been done over big time, and how so many people are starving, struggling just to make it, and all these people that have killed themselves so far because they've had everything taken from them. I see Greece as basically a window into our own future.
It could be.
And it wouldn't shock me at all when I don't think it's a question of if they're going to end up taking away retirement and Social Security and all this other stuff, all these other you know pieces of scrap, you know, that while they chew down the nice juicy steaks. I think it's only a matter of time before they do take all that away. And when they take all that away, then a lot of people in this country, which depend on those Social Security checks and retirement, etc., they're gonna find that the rug has been pulled out from under them.
And it's already happening. And it's going to get worse.
It is. And I think there's been several instances in several states now where this has happened to several numbers of government employees.
Well, that's interesting. They must have overspent.
Yeah. But, I mean, it's not just the federal government that's gotten us into a mountain of debt. Most states now, there's a few exceptions, but most of the states, most of the local governments, they're all in debt. They're all in the red, just like the Gingrich and Santorum campaigns.
Newt the bankrupt.
Yeah.
I picked up a piece. I forget which city it was in offhand. And a policeman told one of my subscribers, he said, they don't have enough money to pay us. He said, we've been riding around like we're supposed to at night. They've already shut the streetlights off. And we can't really drive at all unless we get a direct order to do so. So there's no search for probable criminals. And so that they don't have to expend the gasoline.
I did remember hearing something. I don't know if it's the same town, but I think they did something very similar in Camden, New Jersey. But it wouldn't surprise me at all, Bob, that this is probably going to start happening more and more throughout the entire country. They're going to start, cutting the corners and doing away with, like you just said, not only the, limiting the ability of law enforcement to respond to criminal activities, but also the basic services such as streetlights, et cetera.
Yep, and that allows the criminal element to just go wild. Somebody kicks in your front door. You either get robbed and hope they don't kill you, or you blow them back out again.
Yeah, I definitely see things heading towards a very dystopian future, Bob. And it's going to be like that. It's going to be to where people are just going to have to rely on themselves for self-defense, or they're going to have to really forge friendships and alliances with their fellow neighbors.
Who more often than not have nothing. No food, no water filter, no weapons. And they expect you to take care of them. Out of, a group of 20 homes, two are probably empty. And out of that, probably half of them have weapons. The problem is they're low caliber and they don't know how to use them. They think it's just like in the movies. It isn't.
No, it's not. And that's, it goes back to what you were talking about, the whole planning ahead, and people don't even, most people don't even bother saving anymore. They're just all concerned about spending, getting themselves further and further in debt. The same thing goes with them when it comes to self-defense means, like learning how to use a firearm, having the right caliber, instead of just simply a .22, having something more like a .45, to deal with any potential intruder, and they have no sense of self-sufficiency whatsoever. And unfortunately, I think you're absolutely right about that. If it does hit the fan here, no, it's not a question of if. Once again, it's a question of when. There's going to be a lot of people that are going to be caught completely off guard, unprepared, and they're going to be defenseless. And there's only going to be a few individuals out there that saw the light, that realized what was coming our way, and we're getting prepared for it.
Yeah, we're dead on me.
Oh, okay, sorry. But anyways, we're back, Bob. Bob Chapman is my guest. We're website, theinternationalforecaster.com. And we were talking about how people don't really prepare for what's coming their way. They really have no clue. They, like you said, they don't bother doing any sort of saving whatsoever, whether it's money or putting aside some storable food, water, are learning how to use any self-defense items like a firearm. And whenever the time comes, whenever it does hit the fan, Bob, I mean, I think that there's going to be only a number, a few percentages of the population that are actually going to be able to take care of themselves, while everyone else, they're going to be left to, well, either, you know, fend for themselves and fight it out for the scraps, or else they're going to have to go to the government for whatever the government's willing to offer.
That's true. And then in between, you have law enforcement. And what are they to do? The federal government tells their command, there's 20 people over in the woods over there, and they're armed. Go get them. Mm-hmm. And I would think they'd take heavy casualties doing that.
Yeah, and that's going to happen. And it's going to get to the point where it gets so bad where a lot of people are going to stop obeying the local law enforcement. They're going to stop obeying the law, and they're going to fight for whatever they have left to hold on to, whether there's two of them or 20 of them or 200 of them armed to the teeth. There's going to be a lot of law enforcement officers who are given that order, and they're going to be like, no. You know, they're just going to, you know, throw down their badge and run away because they know the consequences. They know that if they go attempt that, they won't be coming back.
And the government could care less.
No, they don't care less about any of their pawns, whether it's in law enforcement or in the military. They'll, you know, send them forward into battle, and whether it's on the streets of America or in Iraq, Afghanistan, and allow them all to be chewed up. And that's a fact that, unfortunately, I think a lot of people, Bob, in the military and in law enforcement don't seem to understand. They don't seem to grasp the idea that, you know, while they're out there serving their country or serving their community, the government doesn't really care for them. The government, you know, wants them to, you know, be used up and tossed away.
They do that there if they're going to very quickly run out of players. It takes years to train people for those jobs. And once they're gone, they're gone.
That's very true. I mean, that was a huge problem that happened in World War II with the Luftwaffe and the, you know, the Japanese, you know, Air Force. They sent up their best fighters instead of keeping them back at base to train the recruits, and they got shot down. And eventually, while they were intimidating at first, you know, these air forces, eventually they were just sending up people that had never sit in a cockpit against aces in the Allied forces, and they were getting torn up.
That's true to this extent. But I don't think Americans realize the devastating effects of the Luftwaffe during World War II. Many of these men who survived shot down over 300 planes. That's incredible. I think the high one was 381 or 341. Gunther Rau, which was his name. And after the war, he went to work for the German Air Force. Along with Adolf Galland, who was the head of the Air Force, but he was only number two. Bormann was number one. He didn't know what he was doing. Real out of his depth. I've talked to some of those people before they died. Yeah, can you imagine going out in the morning on the Eastern Front, and it's you alone, and there's 12 Russian airplanes driving American aircraft attacking you, and you shoot them all down? I mean, it's incredible.
Now, I mean, there are definitely still a few aces that obviously survived World War II on the side of the Luftwaffe. And it just shows you, you know, from all aspects, of course, not just Nazi Germany, but the Soviet Union, Imperial Japan, how these tyrannical regimes of the past, they really didn't have a problem with sending people up in are to the front lines, whether it's on the ground or in the air, with little or no experience, just to be used as cannon fodder. And the same thing's happening here in the United States. They're going to send, you know, law enforcement in along with the soldiers and troops when the time comes. And they're, like you've mentioned time and time again, Bob, when they go up against the American people, they're going to be torn up.
Yeah, it's the element of people who have been in combat and an element of people who are very competent at firearms. And, you know, I know lots of policemen. And Judy and I used to practice at the police academy. And Judy used to meet the guys all the time. And there weren't many female officers at that time. And they really get upset about it. We had to stop shooting there because of the animosity. And, you know, she was wheeling a S&W 6-inch Highway Patrolman 357 mag. And most of them were firing 38s because that's all it could carry at that time.
Well, they would have definitely been no match for her in a gunfight. 38's going up against a 357.
Great weapon.
It is.
I prefer the 357 auto nowadays.
That's a very nice firearm. I'm just a bit old-fashioned. I kind of like the look and the feel of a 1911 45. I just like it. There's just something nostalgic about it. And, you know, it has good stopping power. And, you know, it doesn't hold as many rounds as, say, a 9mm. But, I mean, if you want to go for rounds, I guess you could go get yourself a little 22.
Well, I have a fully tricked out 45 auto. And I can hit somebody probably 5 out of 7 rounds at 30 feet on a dead run. That's how accurate it is.
Wow. That's nice. Bob Chapman is my guest. His website is theinternationalforecaster.com. And, Bob, the gold and silver prices, they're kind of, they're up today. See, gold is up by, right now it's at $1,675.10. Silver is also up a little bit by, it's at $32.32. A lot of this is being done, of course, like you've pointed out time and time again, market manipulation. How much higher do you think gold and silver should actually be? And when do you think the bottom is finally going to fall out and they're both going to start to really skyrocket?
Well, the timing is impossible. But gold, if it were to go to its proper value at this time, would be $9,000 an ounce, and silver would be $500. And they're doing everything in their power to keep it down. But they can't do it indefinitely because they just don't have enough to do it. And a lot of their attacks on the market, they being in the government, a lot of their attacks on the government are from the derivative sector. And that's making your inroads and keeping people from accumulating. Because when you have that type of volatility, people say, gee, I don't want to get involved in that. And so a lot of people are misled, and that's unfortunate.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. People, unfortunately, out there have been, you know, getting conned into handing over their silver and gold for scraps of paper. But for everyone else, I would say, you know, including me, you know, my own advice is stay the course and hold on to your gold and silver. And eventually, it's going to skyrocket sooner before later. Bob, we got about a minute left. How can people get the International Forecaster?
Go to theinternationalforecaster.com. The International, forecaster.com. We have an email for those of you who want to ask questions. We answer everyone. And also you can get copies there. And you can get a copy of our latest report on gold and silver shares. And for those of you who want to call collect, that number is 877-479-8178. 877-479-8178. You can get free copies there, and you can also get a free one-year subscription. They're making an offering there that's really terrific. If you want to be a subscriber, you should go there.
That is the best place to go to get the International Forecaster, a phenomenal source of information. Bob, thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. I will talk to you next week, sir.
Gotcha. Bye-bye.
There he goes, Bob Chapman. His website is theinternationalforecaster.com. And be sure and catch Bob every Thursday on the Freedom Files podcast. And join us Monday through Thursday, 9 to 11 Central, 10 to midnight Eastern, for the Freedom Files radio show on RonPaulRadio.com.